is the Lord. In the book of 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, it is written, ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. For the past few sermons, I have been preaching and testifying about the fullness of the Holy Ghost. Not only to be born of God's Spirit, but to be filled with God's Spirit. Looking back in the book of Acts of how the apostles were filled with the Holy Ghost. And is Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever? It is our heart's desire to have that same infilling of the Holy Ghost that the apostles had in the book of Acts. When we're filled with the Holy Ghost, we can be witnesses unto the Lord Jesus Christ, as Christ Jesus says, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost hath come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and all of Judea and Samaria, and to the uttermost part of the earth. And also, when we're filled with God's Spirit, we can boldly testify that greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And because greater is he that is in us than he that is in this world, we can be overcomers. For us that are born of God's Spirit, for us that are filled with the Spirit of God. Many years ago, back in the year 2007, I believe it was, myself and two other brothers in Christ for America, we traveled to the Thai-Burmese border on a mission with boxfuls of New Testaments in the Karen tribal tongue. For before that, during December timeframe, as I was invited to the Thai-Burmese border to preach at a Burmese church, at the preaching the gospel at the Burmese church, I met a man who was high-ranking in the KNLA, the Karen National Liberation Army. And he asked us if we could stay a few more days, he would take us throughout the different villages to preach the gospel. This man came from the front lines and is very appreciative of the gospel that I was preaching, the gospel of Christ. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God and the salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. After staying there for a few days and preaching the gospel in different Karen tribal churches on the Thai-Burmese border, we let this man know that the Lord had blessed us with boxfuls of New Testaments in the Karen tongue. The outside of the Bibles were in the camouflage color. They were pocket-sized New Testaments, perfect for soldiers on the front lines, especially during that time as the Karen National Liberation Army was fighting the Burmese Army, as well as the DBKA, the Democratic Buddhist Karen Army, and quite a many of them were dying on the front lines. And this man knew they needed the gospel, and he let us know that if we turned back and gave him those boxfuls of New Testaments and the Karen tongue, he would see to it that soldiers on the front lines would receive those New Testaments. How do we have New Testaments such as that in the Karen tongue? We did not ask. We did not beg. We did not hint. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. And Jesus Christ says, our Father knoweth the things we have need of before we even ask. For Christ gives us a promise that if we seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, the kingdom of God and his righteousness, that all these things shall be added unto us. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. As I've been serving the Lord for over two decades now, we've never lacked in Bibles or gospel tracts without us ever having to ask, beg, or hint. Praise ye the Lord. So we return back a few weeks later two brothers in Christ of America and myself, with boxfuls of New Testaments in the Karen tongue. We arrived to the town of Sanklabri on the Thai-Burmese border in the late afternoon time. We took a bot bus to the village on the border where that man lived to give him those New Testaments, and then we returned back to the town of Sanklabri. After traveling all day from Bangkok to Sanklabri, and then traveling to the very edge to the border where that village is located, where that man lived at, and then traveling back to Sanklabri town, we are very tired and sleepy. Before we went to that border village, we rented a small little boathouse that was very cheap with three rooms on it. Now, most people take these boathouses and go in the middle of the lake, and the lake is so big, it looks like you're on an ocean. Of course, we didn't do such a thing. We just sit in there because it was very cheap, and we'd each have our own separate room. Why would we need our own separate room for? So we could pray, or I could pray in secret without having to worry about waking anybody up as I wake up a great while for this yet day to seek the Lord while he may be found. We put our suitcases, our duffel bags, into that boathouse, took those Bibles to the border, came back that evening, and then we went to a small little restaurant on top of a hill to eat some very cheap and very good and clean food. We're very worn out. We're very tired. After eating dinner in the evening time, we went back down to that small boathouse that we had rented. We first arrived there in the late afternoon time. We were the only people renting a boathouse. And of course, we'd be the only people who would leave the boathouse there on the shore. Most people would take the boathouse way out into the middle of the lake somewhere. That's not why we were there. We were there to deliver those Bibles, so we kept the boathouse on the shore. Nobody else was there that late afternoon. But now, in the late evening or nighttime hours, as we walked down that hill from where we ate a late dinner at, we saw that next to our boathouse, another boathouse was tied to it, filled with Buddhist monks and what you would call Christmas lights all around that boathouse, all lit up. Of course, this surprised us. We thought nobody else would be there, as it was empty. We got there in the late afternoon, and most would take a boathouse into the middle of the lake. But for some reason, they tied it, their boathouse, next to ours. There's different shapes of boathouses there in Sanklabri. The one that we rented had three bedrooms, a little living room area, and one restroom. That way we could each have our own private rooms and be able to fellowship in the living room area, which was outside where we could overlook the lake. Other boathouses were designed for monks. That was those whole empty big boathouses with one restroom that monks could take the boathouse, or people could rent the boathouse with the monks to go chant on the lake somewhere. You see, that lake is a result of a human dam, and they had flooded the old town of Sanklabri before. And when the water goes down, buildings from the old town can be seen, such as their former Buddhist temples. And for these heathen Buddhists with a Buddhist temple in the middle of the lake, they will go take boathouses and chant near those temples. But for some reason that night, they decided to attach one of those boathouses for Buddhist monks to chant in next to our boathouse. We were too sleepy to figure this out. We were too sleepy to even care. We had been traveling all day long. It was now nighttime. We were ready to sleep, as we're gonna head back to Bangkok the very next day. We'd only gone there to drop off those boxes of Karen New Testaments. New Testaments in the Karen tribal tongue. As we got to our boathouse and went to sleep, I woke up the next morning about 4 a.m. to seek the Lord while he may be found. When I got out of my room, I saw that in our boathouse, not only were attached to those Buddhist monks next to us, and their boathouse was all lit up with what we would call Christmas lights, they put all these strings attaching those monks to the boathouse we're in. Not a few strings, many strings. So much so, they had a bob and weave just to get to the bathroom to brush my teeth, take care of some personal business in the bathroom to come back to my room to pray to the Lord in my prayer closet there in that private room. I knew when I came out of the bathroom after washing my face and waking up a little bit what those Buddhist monks were up to. You see, before I was born again, I used to practice Buddhism, especially the Theravada Buddhism that's practiced here in Thailand, which they also mix with Brahmanism, Brahmin Hinduism, as well as animism, the worship of spirits. In fact, most Thais will confess that animism is the foundation of their religion. Though many Westerners would say that Thailand is a Buddhist country, or claim that most of the Thai people are Buddhists, and in fact, they're all animists. Animism, the worship of spirits, which we would call devils, is the foundation of their religion here in Thailand. With that in mind, these monks were doing a ceremony to cast out spirits. Not only was it Buddhist monks, they had a very famous Buddhist monk. He was the most famous Buddhist monk in that area. This man was from the Mon tribe, and in the Mon tribe, he actually came from royal blood. But he went into the monastery and gave his life to Buddhism. And Thais from all over Thailand would travel to that town of Sanklaburi to worship that aforementioned Buddhist monk. In fact, Sanklaburi is named after the Sangha. That is the first Buddhist council. And when you travel from Kanchanaburi, or Bangkok to Kanchanaburi, and Kanchanaburi Sanklaburi, the first you see for into the town is idols, huge idols of the Buddha's first council, or what they call the Sangha, hence the name Sanklaburi. This Buddhist monk is the abbot of that area that is named after the first Buddhist council of the Sangha or the Sanklaburi. This man is worshipped and revered all over Thailand. And he was the one leading the rest of the monks in that chant towards us to try to cast the spirit out of us. Once again, it is written, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. There is one sin that God cannot and will not pardon, that is sinning against the Holy Ghost. It is the unpardonable sin. When I woke up and realized at 4 a.m. what these Buddhist monks were doing and who they had called on, because see, a month prior, we had commandeered another Buddhist temple in that area to preach the gospel. There in Sanklaburi, they have the longest or the tallest, one or the other, wooden bridge in Thailand built by Buddhist monks, which we had commandeered for the preaching of the gospel. And these Buddhists were tired of it. These Buddhists wanted to fight back. And they fought back in their Buddhist ways of having their most revered abbot, their most revered Buddhist monk, to lead other monks in this ceremony to try to cast the spirit out of us. But greater is he that is in us than he that is in this world, the Holy Ghost. Not only are we born of God's Spirit, we follow the apostles' examples to be filled with the Spirit of God, making sure that every hindrance is shaken or removed out of our lives, that we get out the fullness of the Holy Ghost. Because we are preaching the gospel on the mission field in the 1040 window in a third world country in which not even 1% of the population professes any form of Christianity. A place that is in great need of the gospel. In order to do so in a place such as this, in which the majority of the population have given themselves over to animism or the worship of spirits or devils, we need power. Holy Ghost power. Those who would compromise with the Lord, those who would not go all the way with the Lord, they must leave this mission field. They'll never make it and never produce fruit here. This place of Thailand has been called, amongst the missionaries, the graveyard of missionaries. Not because they're martyred or killed physically, because they die out spiritually and don't make it here. We need power, the fullness of the Holy Ghost. And when we have this power, we can boldly say, greater is he that is in us than he that is in this world. There at 4 a.m, with all those strings around me, the toothbrush and toothpaste in my hand, my soap dish in my hand, a towel wrapped around my body, I wanted to stop those Buddhist monks. I wanted to go over to their little boathouse and warn them of what they were doing, but knowing it would just be like throwing gas on the fire. They'd mistake what I was saying. They would think I was challenging them or threatening them. There was nothing more that I could do but continue back to my small room to get down on my knees after shutting the door and praying to my Father which seeth what is done in secret. And yes, that morning, I prayed to God with tears in my eyes, knowing those Buddhist monks were playing with fire, knowing there's no forgiveness of sinning against the Holy Ghost, and I prayed it through that morning. After I finished praying and the two other professing Christians woke up from their nice sleep, I told them what was going on and that we needed to get out of there as fast as possible, for I was really feeling sorry for those Buddhist monks. God would have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth, but there are many that reject God's will. There are many who choose their sins, who choose their idols over God, such as those Buddhist monks. And would go to such great lengths in the rejection of the Lord to even commit the unpardonable sin. We left there that morning, traveled all day back to Bangkok, Thailand, arrived here in the late afternoon time, and that evening, here in this building we're living at, on the fourth floor, there is some laundromats. And one of the ladies who owns the laundromats is from the south of Thailand, from the province of Nakhon Si Thammalat. And being that I've lived in the south of Thailand myself and can speak some of the southern Thai dialect of the Thai tongue, this woman knows of me as we preach the gospel to her many of times. This same woman is a devout Buddhist. She is the reason why every year they invite Buddhist monks into this building to chant and to quote unquote bless this building. This woman goes her way to spend the money to invite those Buddhist monks here once a year. She is a very devout Buddhist. Here in this building that evening, she asked my wife, has your husband been traveling anywhere recently? So my wife let her know, oh, he just arrived back from Sanklabri. And she said to my wife, did you know that so-and-so, that famous Buddhist monk from the Mon tribe, who was of Mon royalty, who was revered all over Thailand, had died that afternoon? My wife came back to her room and told me what she had learned from that lady who owns a laundromat. So I went down there to look at the front page of the newspaper to see the picture of that monk had died that afternoon. I forgot to read the news article. I forgot to even ask the lady who owned the laundromat, why did she even ask if I'd been traveling? Maybe they had written about us in that newspaper, and this lady who knew me personally put two and two together and realized it was me that went there. Maybe they told their version of the story. Maybe they even blamed us Christians. I do not know, and I do not care. You see, gossiping is not a sin in the Bible. Of course, backbiting is, but not gossiping. In the book of Ecclesiastes, we're given a commandment to not listen to gossip. Why? Because the Word of God says we have done the exact same things ourselves. Do not listen to your servant cursing you, for you have done the same yourself. Not only are we commanded not to backbite, we're commanded not even to pay attention to any gossip. So when I saw on the front page that monk had truly died, I went back to my room amazed. I knew what killed that monk. Of course, it wasn't us. It was his sin against the Holy Ghost, trying to cast the spirit out of us through their Buddhist animus ceremony, which completely backfired on them, because greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. Not only born of God's spirit, we're also filled with the spirit of God. In a country such as this, I never leave my room without first being prayed up, tarrying in the prayer closet until I'm endued with power from on high. Once again, this is the mission field. This is a country that's been given over to idolatry. Once again, this is a country in which the majority of the population are animists and worship spirits or devils. In order for a Christian to serve the Lord in a place such as this, we need the fullness of the Holy Ghost. We need to have that power, Holy Ghost power, to be a witness unto Christ and to serve the Lord here. And when we're filled with the Holy Ghost, when we're endued with that power from on high, we can boldly testify that greater is he that is in us than he that is in this world. And it's a scary thing for those who would dare sin against the spirit that is within us. Back in 2010, I was preaching the gospel in the Chiang Mai Night Bazaar on my own at that time. And while I was preaching the gospel, a quote-unquote missionary from America was very upset at the preaching of the gospel. According to his beliefs, I had a religious spirit in me. And while I was preaching the gospel, endued with power from on high, baptized with the Holy Ghost, that quote-unquote missionary dared to try to cast a spirit out of me. But the spirit that is in me is the Holy Ghost. And greater is he that is in me than he that is in this world. And I have no idea what happened to that missionary. But he had sinned. A sin that's unpardonable. A sin that you cannot be forgiven for. Sinning against the Holy Ghost. Even this past December, a young man from America called me. He heard from these sermons that I was going to preach the gospel on the Thai-Burmese border, being invited to preach at a village, and he wanted to join me. Of course, I let him know he's not welcome because we were there on invitation. We wouldn't have enough room in the 4x4 vehicle to take us to that village, as we have to go off-roading, and that 4x4 vehicle was going to be full. They've already planned this out a month ahead of time and who would be in that vehicle. And then the quote-unquote house we're living in, it was going to be filled with people. And there was no room for this man to join us. Well, he got offended by that he could not join us. So he called me back again to tell me he had a friend here in Thailand from Canada who also speaks the Karen tongue. Well, I let him know that doesn't change things. There's still no room for him in the 4x4 vehicle. There's still no room for him in the house we're staying in the village. We had not planned ahead of time. And I don't even know this man. How can we travel together to the Thai-Burmese border? We might even have to sleep in the same bed together. And I don't even know him. So let him know it doesn't matter if a friend from Canada speaks a Karen tongue. All those in that village speak Karen already. Most of them understand Thai, and the pastor can translate from Thai into the Karen tongue. But he got so offended by that. He got so angry at me by that. He then said that I had a spirit of pride in me. No, I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. And to blaspheme God's Holy Spirit and to call the Holy Ghost a spirit of pride is a very dangerous thing. A sin in which there is no forgiveness. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in this world. In serving the Lord in such a country as this, it is not a game. No. This is for life. This is real. And to serve the Lord in a country such as this It takes us who are born of God's Spirit to be filled with God's Spirit, to have the fullness of the Holy Ghost. And those who had dared to sin against He that is in us, who is greater than he that is in this world, are in a very dangerous place. If God be for us, who can be against us? For greater is he that is in us than he that is in this world. Are you saved? Are you born again? And what on earth are you doing for heaven's sake? Are you comfortable in your first world country? Do you have enough mammon yet? It's time to serve the Lord if you are saved. It's time to take up your cross and follow the Lord. Christ says to go ye into all the world, not your home country, not your neighborhood, into all the world, especially countries such as this, and preach the gospel to every creature. But in order to do so, you need the fullness of the Holy Ghost. You need to be filled with God's Spirit, endued with power from on high. For Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father except by him. For neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Repent ye and believe the gospel. God bless you.